willing to show off the stuff of his love. In the early 70s, an era littered with the sweet sounds of acoustic guitars and aren't I sensitive lyrics, a new outlaw sound was born. Loud and brash, Deep Purple would define the new heavy metal. Burning up the fretboard was Ritchie Blackmore, a guitar god who demanded to be heard. The band let loose at a blistering 105 decibels. Put your ear against a car alarm and you pretty much get the idea.
When I was on stage and I'll be playing with my amplifier, which was a 280 watt Marshall amplifier, which was the loudest amplifier ever built, I used to point it at the singer. So consequently, his hearing is not so good. Mine is perfect.
In 1972, with just four notes, Ritchie Blackmore composed one of rock's heaviest anthems and one of the century's most repeated riffs.
I first wrote Smoke on the Water, I think, around the fact that I'd heard these intervals played in fourths by a keyboard player called Graham Bond. And if you had just the note, the root note, you'd have. But if you add the fourth, gives it that kind of darkness, that evil overtones. So consequently, I'm now a wizard. The most drastic way my life changed when Smoke on the Water came out and was a hit was that we toured so much.
In 1975, craving independence, Ritchie Blackmore left Deep Purple.
I felt that the band, the egos were getting a little bit too much. Everybody was used to traveling around in limos and staying at the best hotels. I felt that music was suffering. I wanted to form a little band and start the whole procedure over again.
Ritchie did just that. He called his new band Rainbow. I can't break away from your spell.
You'll leave me someday. The difference between Rainbow and Purple, to me, was I had control. And in Deep Purple, there was five big egos. And in Rainbow, there was one big ego, that was me. And that suited me.
It was that ego that branded Ritchie as difficult to work with. In fact, the Rolling Stone Encyclopedia of Rock and Roll states that, quote, associates claim that Blackmore is often arrogant and belligerent.
I think Bette Davis said it very well when she said, you're nobody until you're difficult.
So where is he now? After reuniting with Deep Purple and countless reformations of Rainbow, Ritchie and his partner Candace Knight formed Blackmore's Knight in 1997.
I was told once by a friend of mine, she had seen an olden sign.
With their first release, Shadow of the Moon, the band showed off their new musical direction.
I like to visualize ourselves in a tavern in somewhere like Hungary or Germany, with a lot of friends sitting around the fire and singing just some good songs with lots of hand claps and being very drunk and just being very into the music.
As the fields turn to gold down at the Renaissance Fair.
In the spring of 1999, the band released their follow-up record, Under a Violet Moon. Now, for possibly the first time in his career, Ritchie Blackmore is playing music that is all his own.
To be rich within oneself is the ultimate goal. To be at peace with oneself. And I find myself getting there. And that, to me, is what I'm trying to do. Which has nothing to do with playing arenas.
They're the boys who live without limitations. Some did the